I think to keep life interesting, you need to keep learning. I'm Rohit Prakash. I am a data engineering manager. After work, I'm learning to cook at a restaurant. When I was looking for jobs on LinkedIn, I found a company that would support my passions outside of work. I hit apply. I heard back from the recruiter, and here I am. This job, it was exactly what I was looking for.
There are 20 million jobs on LinkedIn. Find one meant for you. LinkedIn, whatever you're in it for, we're in it together.
In supermarkets, there's cheese, and then there's Cracker Barrel cheese. With its rich and bold flavor, Cracker Barrel cheese is simply a cut above. Snacking should be an experience, a moment to savor. That's why Cracker Barrel cheese is your cheese. Cracker Barrel cheese. Snack time. Refined. Cracker Barrel cheese is available in classic chunk and new varieties like cheese and cracker bites, charcuterie-inspired pairing boards, and cubes. Find us in the dairy aisle.
I didn't know what it cuts like. that day, then I would know the joy of coming home. Maybe it's okay if I'm not okay.
Least.
Good morning. Welcome to our graduation service 2019. Thank you all for being here, to making sacrifices, to traveling, whether across the valley, Phoenix, or from out of state, or for a few of you all the way from halfway around the world, from China and Ethiopia, here this morning. Thank you all for making it here today. First of all, to celebrate God's amazing grace in all of our lives, and especially the lives of these 35 graduates, the class of 2019. We'll follow our order of service as printed in your service folder on page 2, and we'll begin by singing the opening song, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Please stand. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. I invite you to participate in the responsive reading from Ephesians chapter 1, 3 to 14. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ.
Creation of the world, to be holy and blameless in his sight.
In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves.
In him we have redemption through his blood, forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace.
With all wisdom and understanding, he made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ, to be put into effect when the times reach their fulfillment, to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ.
In him we are all also chosen, according to the plan of him who works out everything conformity and the purpose of his will. We who were the first to put our hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory.
And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. We pray. Dear Heavenly Father, you blessed us with a beautiful day here to celebrate the end of another school year, the graduation of these seniors as they step away from ALA and follow the plan you already have laid out for them. Remind them, and also all of us, of your blessings at every stage in our lives, and that we can recognize and appreciate those blessings when we're connected to you. Help us see your amazing grace and mercy in our lives as a gift, only made possible through your Son, our Savior Jesus, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Our scripture lesson chosen for today is from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 5, verses 1 to 9. Here Paul reminds us that without God, we are pretty much nothing. We're sinful human beings, powerless in our lives on this earth. And that's exactly why God sent his Son to this world to live, to die, and rise again, so that now we can live as his forgiven children on this earth, blessed with the comfort and peace in our lives, every step of our lives, all the way until he takes us home to be with him in heaven. Paul writes, "Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him?" This is the word of our Lord. I now invite you to sing along with the choir our next song, By Faith, as printed out here in the top of page 4.
Thank you. Morning. A few weeks ago, family and friends, especially class of 2019, a few weeks ago, I was watching part of a movie called Draft Day. And if you haven't ever seen this movie, if you've never heard of this movie, that's totally okay. In fact, when I asked my focus group, which consisted of my teenage daughters, if they had ever heard of this movie, I got this look like, no, really? Why would you even ask? Don't really care to see it either. But the movie isn't important, so if you haven't seen it, don't worry. What's important is that the movie was about conviction. The story of a general manager of his football team on draft day. He had a plan, he was prepared for the day ahead. He had big decisions to make, big things to do. He wrote himself a little note and put it on a sticky note, put it in his pocket and kept it there. And then his world fell apart. His family started coming unglued. His boss threatened to fire him. He had thousands of fans screaming at him, wanting him to do something different, wanting him to do something spectacular, wanting him to save their team. He had colleagues wanting him to make deals that he really didn't want to make. Everything fell apart for him. But at the end of the movie, he chose the player that he had decided beforehand to choose. And we see what was on his little sticky note. If you've ever seen the movie, it had the name of his player, Vontae Mack, and it said, "No matter what." It's a movie about conviction, a man who stayed true to his conviction. And the reason why that struck me when I was watching it, it's the same conviction that's in your verse. Your verse is full of conviction, the verse that you chose for today. It's full of conviction, someone staying true to their conviction. It's about a God who is convicted, a God who has a conviction about you, to care about you no matter what. If there's one thing I can pray and ask for today for you, it's that you also hold to your conviction. For the rest of your life, for you, it will be God. No matter what. No matter what. I don't know what brought you here to Arizona Lutheran Academy or what led your parents to enroll you. Maybe it was the small class sizes. Maybe it was the good academic preparation for life that you are going to receive, much better than average. Maybe they wanted a good, safe, moral environment. Those things are all good. Those things are all things that you've received here at Arizona Lutheran Academy. But the faculty and staff here has given you something even greater. They've given you something even greater. They've taught you, they've lived it. They've shown you a God who cares about you no matter what. And that's what your verse is about. Your verse, you see, is the climax, the last verses of a chapter that dedicated to showing you how awesome it is to worship a God who is so incredible, so wonderful, so beyond compare. It's the grand climax, the grand finale of this entire chapter describing a God that you've come to know and trust. A God that Isaiah marvels, a God who is so big and so awesome and so powerful that the nations literally are like a drop in a bucket to him. He uses those words, a drop in the bucket, like dust on a scale. He talks about how the finest craftsman in the world could not begin to capture the image of the God that you've come to know. Nothing in wood, nothing in metal, nothing in stone, not even the best craftsman in the world could begin to compare to a living God who created all of those dead objects. He talks about a God so powerful and so wonderful that he calls the stars by name. He knows every single one of them. A God that calls you by name. A God that knew your name before you were born. A God who cares about you no matter what. You have to understand the people that Isaiah was writing to are no real different from us. They could never love God as much as he loved them, and neither can we. But that didn't matter. He was a God who cared no matter what. A God who never stopped caring. A God who showed his care and concern for his people by coming into this world to die for him. That's the God you've come to know. That's the God that you trust. A God who never gets tired. A God who never gets weary. A God stronger than you can imagine, more powerful than you can imagine, and he cares about you no matter what. That's the greatest gift you've received here. It's the greatest gift you've seen modeled by your teachers, by the staff. It's the most important relationship in your life. My prayer for you is that your conviction will also remain. That as you leave here, for you, it will be God, no matter what. Maybe today is the end, and maybe it's kind of a scary thing. You've become so comfortable here, right? You know everyone. They're like your family, brothers and sisters. You've been around people for so long. You've been around this facility for so long. It's become so safe and so wonderful and so comfortable to you, and now you go out into the great unknown, and what's going to happen? You've probably heard that before. You've been prepared for everything, but you've also been told that the adult world and adult life is not quite so easy, not without its challenges, not without its temptations. So my prayer for you is that no matter what happens, it's God no matter what. That is your conviction, and you stay true to that conviction. You have been prepared. Have been prepared for anything that you will face. And your strength in the years ahead will not be yours. Pressure to make decisions and handle life will not be yours alone, left up to your intelligence and your will and your power. You have a God who's bigger than that. And when life is overwhelming and you're wondering which way to go, I'd encourage you, go back and read your verse. In fact, go back and read the entire chapter and remind yourself just what kind of God you've come to know here at Arizona Lutheran Academy. Just what kind of God is taking care of you, how strong he is, and how he will never get tired, how he will never get weary, and how he will care about you no matter what. Maybe in 25 years you'll gather together. Things will be a lot different. Maybe in 25 years you'll be marveling at how much hair has disappeared. or how you don't quite look the same as you used to back then, even despite all the things that money can buy. You'll look at how things turned out and how the years have passed, how people have changed and how they haven't. But the one thing that I hope you still have is that conviction that for you it's been God no matter what. That you're able to go back and see Him and rely on Him and maintain that relationship with Him. That you'll come back and you'll talk about your life experiences with each other, and you'll be able to say, you know, when I was tired, when I was weak, there was my God. He gave me strength. Strength when I was weak, strength when I was weary. He's the one who enabled me to keep running the course that was laid out for me when I was tired. My hope in Him has never been disappointed. It never will. This is your God. He cares about you no matter what. And my prayer for you is that it will be the same model in your life. For you, it will be God, no matter what. Amen.
This is my word.
I invite you to join in the responsive prayer with me on page 6, followed by the Lord's Prayer on page 7. As we close our school year, let us come before our Father in heaven to ask his blessing and to offer our thanks. Father, you have brought us to the end of this school year by your grace. Lead us now to gratefully acknowledge the blessings you have given us in body, mind, and spirit. Lord, in your mercy. We thank you, Father, for Christian parents, teachers, and peers who have served us for our good and blessing. May their efforts bear fruit in lives that continue to grow in faith, hope, and love for Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy. As we part for a time or go on to new stages of life, keep us safe in your protecting care. Refresh us through leisure and rest. Renew in us the desire to grow in all useful knowledge and in the wisdom that comes from you. Lord, in your mercy. Father, into your hands we commend all that we have and are, asking for your blessing for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. We'll close our service today by singing our last song, On Eagle's Wings, on the following page. This ends our graduation worship service, and it's my privilege now to invite our two class speakers to the stage, Noah Stotz and Ben Meyer.
Family, alumni, and of course, to my fellow classmates. Well, here we are, class of 2019, our high school graduation. Isn't it crazy that we've accomplished 4 long years of writing papers, memorizing equations, and cramming for tests? It seems like just yesterday it was our first day of high school. Some of us were stepping onto familiar grounds with childhood friends, familiar faces, and clear expectations. Others, such as I, were entering a foreign campus with 200 strangers, a clean slate, and high hopes. Now look at us. Somehow, between that first day and today, we became more than strangers. Some of us became strictly acquaintances, while others became best friends. But in the end, all of us became family. Yes, I know that sounds extremely cheesy, and many of you are probably thinking, I will never see you again after high school. Well, although that may be true, I argue that our class has endured far too much together to be considered anything less than family. Let me recall a few instances that I'm referring to. Our class was the first class to experience all 3 years of MAP testing, a day off of school due to water deprivation, and a winter formal our freshman year. We were also the last class to graduate with Mr. Edmondson, Miss O, and Miss Steinmetz, to be required to take 2 years of computer apps, and to, again, experience a winter formal our freshman year. Together we laughed, we cried, we made some mistakes, and we learned from them. Within our own individual timeline, we changed and witnessed each other change into the adults we are today. Some of us grew spiritually, personally, intellectually, or physically. I myself have grown in all of those areas. Well, except physically. If anything, I shrank in that area. Starting at ALA freshman year, I knew no one, and no one knew me. I was an outsider, if you will. It was not long before I became aware of the bonded community that I had stepped into. Students knew students, whose parents knew their parents, whose parents were taught by parents of teachers that teach at my school. And the closest relationship I had to this school was that it was around 10 minutes from my house. Other than attending summer camps and orientations, I had no relationship to ALA, nor the people attending it. Everyone in ALA seemed to be already linked or connected. I wondered, how could I, an outsider, ever become linked? How could I ever fit into this close community? Although not all of us had a grandparent that went to school with Mr. Gray, or a parent that was taught by Miss T, we all found our little niche in this community. We found friends to support us, teachers to guide us, and a savior to lead us. I realized that despite who we were before high school, or where we came from before ALA, we all played a role in shaping each other's lives, which helps each of us grow in all aspects. Maybe many of you felt like an outsider when starting your freshman year. Maybe you will feel like one when starting college or a new job. But as Christians, are we not already outsiders in this world? We have this sure hope and faith in something that many cannot see. We all have this common factor, a link, Jesus. Maybe in a sense, I was simply an outsider joining a group of outsiders. We all helped each other grow together in the love of Christ, thus deepening our relationship with one another. Each and every day of our high school career, we attended chapel, religion class, and Bible center teachings. We listened as teachers urged us to take advantage of this daily Christian fellowship. Although, yes, I'll be the first to admit, sometimes the message felt redundant and we found ourselves dozing off in chapel or messing around in classes, I think we can all agree that the message of our Savior was the most important lesson taught at ALA. I'm sorry, Mr. Steiner. AP Calc was a very close second. Now, as high school comes to a close, we are to turn a page and begin a new chapter of our lives. Some of us will be embraced in a community that knows of God's love. Others will be surrounded by people who do not. Many of you will feel how I did when starting my freshman year, yet not all of you will have the luxury of daily Christian fellowship. Here at ALA, we were constantly reminded of God's word. We had people to keep us on a straight path when we wandered. Now, we are on the brink of adulthood, where we are able to make our own choices, make our own mistakes, and decide whether or not we're going to learn from them. There will most likely not be someone to hold us accountable for every poor decision or missed opportunity. It is now our responsibility to take what we've learned from ALA and use it to not only guide our own lives, but to shape others' lives around us. We have to take the link that bonded us together here and connect it to the world around us. This loving community that we've created within our class at ALA does not have to end at graduation. As long as we treasure God's love, we will always be connected and connect to others along the way. So today, as we take our last steps as high school students, we are faced with the first of many choices. A choice to hold fast to what we've learned or to stray away. A choice to make these last 4 years worth the stress, anxiety, and sleep deprivation. Even though we may have undergone a massive amount of change and growth these last four years, this is not where it ends. Our choices from here on out determine how we are going to represent our Savior in our lifetime. He may use some of us to become doctors, pilots, teachers, writers, engineers, or entrepreneurs. In whatever adventure or endeavor you plan on attacking next, I hope you never dull the light that God has lit in you, but instead choose to spread it to the world around you. I urge you to hold fast to what shaped your yesterdays and use it to be everything you can be in your coming tomorrows. On behalf of all the students, I want to thank everyone who taught us, mentored us, believed in us, and tolerated us throughout our educational, personal, and spiritual lives thus far. And with that said, I wish you, class of 2019, the best of luck as you embark on this wonderful journey. Congratulations, friends. We made it. Thank you.
Hello. How are you guys? Good. All right. Before I begin, I'd like to thank the Academy, Arizona Lutheran Academy, for preparing us for 4 years to walk this stage to be handed that glorified piece of paper, which we actually get in the office afterwards, called a diploma that apparently you need nowadays. But before all that begins, I would like to thank a few people. I'd like to personally thank Mr. Tony Stark for snapping his fingers and saving the entire universe. I would also like to thank my parents, my grandparents, because without my grandparents, I couldn't be thanking my parents. I would also like to thank any other friends or family that have come here today that have supported all of us throughout our 18-year journey here. It's been a fun 4 years with y'all. I'm honored to be representing the class of 2019. And you know, I tried to look back at all the memories we created, but honestly, sophomore year on back, that's like a big blur. I can't remember any of that. Must have run out of space from all the memory passages, the study guides, and the Macbeth quotes that we had to memorize and put on tests. But writing this speech gave me a new appreciation for all the memories that I create and the ones that I can remember. Let's make one more, though. One more memory under this roof, ALA's roof. Because as for high school, this is the end game. We worked hard to get to this day, very, very hard. And I would like to stand up here and say we worked tirelessly 24/7 on everything, but I mean, the truth is, we worked way harder. I mean, 4 years of classes, countless group projects, too many tests to count, late night assignments for us procrastinators out there. I see you guys, yeah. And all the rainforests worth of term papers that we had to complete, and years of sports. Come to think of it, it took 15 teachers to challenge, encourage, and motivate us, 35 of us, for the 720 days of our education. And here we are. They did it, and we did it. We survived, and they survived. Barely. Now, some of us were here from 7 in the morning to 10 o'clock at night, depending on practice or sporting events. So if you really think about it, ALA was our home away from home. Now, Mrs. Tierney, I don't know where she is, but she would be glad to know that I looked up the definition of a home on Wikipedia. It's great. I mean, it's a website where anyone, anywhere in the world can write whatever they want. So you know you're getting the best possible information. Anyway, Wikipedia states the definition of a home as an institution for elderly people that need supervision. Oh, wait. That's just where the faculty lives. Another definition is the place where one lives permanently. Yes, I guess that definition works too. But home is not just a place or thing. It's an adverb, an adjective, and a verb transitive, people. A verb transitive. It's a belonging, an attitude, a consciousness of creating memories. The teachers and staff watched out for us, steered us in the right direction, encouraged us in faith, cheered for us, and they were proud of us. And sometimes they disciplined us, but we won't talk about that right now. ALA has been our home for 4 years, and it's decorated with years and years of unforgettable memories. I think we can all look back and appreciate the environment that ALA provided for us in some way or another, because they were all worthwhile. They were all fun. Some were better than others, I can attest to that, but they were all worthwhile. And in our home, each person brought their own different background, their own unique personality, their own outstanding talents. For some of them, their own knowledge, their own corny yet funny humor, and made the class of 2019 the absolute best class ever. Cue applause. I've gone to school with some of these people for 4 years, others of them 12 plus, and I'm proud to call them my family. But don't lose sight of all the things you've learned here. Don't lose sight of all the things you've learned, the experiences you've had, the opportunities given, because someday it's going to be fun to look back on these memories and reflect on our time here at ALA. I, for one, have a few memories, and here are some of them that come to mind. The time when Mr. Rosenbaum slow danced with Mr. E to Whitney Houston. The time Mr. E, or his DJ name, Eazy-E, and I had a dance-off. I ended up dropping him. The time when Jamie split his pants at prom. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. That was singular. The times Jamie split his pants at prom. And, oh, look here, life lessons, people. Never play baseball using a hydro flask as a bat. Because we did that, and it ended up flying out of the person's hand and straight into a face. Good times. Another memory is the many times that our class dominated the homecoming games. All the volleyball games in which the Hype Zone participated in. And one of my favorite memories here, actually, are the school dances. And it's just fascinating to look back at the number of new dance moves created just within our 4 years. I mean, you have the whip, nay-nay. The Orange Justice, you have the shoot. If you guys don't know what those are, ask later. Otherwise, it's probably too late. And the number of times we did those dance moves, I mean, using a simple calculation, the song Watch Me came out our freshman year, meaning that throughout all our school dances, we as a class of 35 people have done the whip nay-nay almost 6,000 times. For those of you who don't know how to do that, just ask these students. And then we have the more memories of when we acted out the entire play of Macbeth or visited the cadaver with Mr. Gray. And the Dave Ramsey class that taught us how to avoid college debt. Let's see how that works out. Now, I want to thank all my friends who were always there for me, or for each other. We encouraged one another in the classroom, motivated each other in sports. We had dumb jokes, roasts, and one-liners. And if you needed help on something, a classmate wouldn't hesitate to take time out of their day to help you, especially if it meant getting out of the classroom. And in the future, although we may not see each other every day, the memories and bonds that we made will never be lost. Besides, we can keep up on Instagram, or Facebook, or TikTok. Creed Bratton said it best, no matter how you get there, or where you will end up, human beings have this miraculous gift to make that place home. And that's what ALA has been for us. And as you leave behind the memories of this home, I wish you luck as you create your own new home, filled with new friends and your own family. The last 4 years have gone by fast, faster than my parents wanted. ALA has become like an extension of our homes, an extension that brought Christ into our daily life. ALA helped to nurture us as God-fearing men and women, as well as instilled Christian leadership skills into us. And as we go from here, let us remember to do the same with our own families and to create future homes and legacies centered on Christ. These are the best days of your life so far, but we don't always realize that. For the reason that Andy Bernard said best, I wish there was a way to know you're in the good old days before you've actually left them. I just want to say congratulations to the class of 2019. Be proud of your accomplishments and what you have yet to accomplish. And I'm glad that at the end of the day, we can all look in the mirror and say, I am a graduate of the class of 2019. Thank you.
Am I on? Cool. Yes.
Well, congratulations.
Go off again? Good. Take it off. Okay.
Congratulations. Today is your day. You're off to great places. You're off and away.
Ever heard those words before? I use those every year to start my little remarks afterwards. They're written by Dr. Seuss, for many of you, probably your favorite author at some point in your life. And it's a day now that you are experiencing that seemed just 4 years ago to be so far away. And now it's here. And you're a graduate. Dr. Seuss also said one other thing I like to share each year. Sometimes he wrote, "You will never know the value of a moment until it becomes a memory." And that's high school now. It's all over. And it's a memory. And I think as you look back on your experiences here, you're going to see some value that's going to affect the rest of your life. I want to tell you right now, you're no longer a 4. Not yet a 3. But you are a solid 2. You like riddles? Some rules are kind of silly, like knock, knock. Beth. Beth wishes on your graduation. Some of them were stated by very intelligent and expert kind of people, like Batman's nemesis, the Riddler, who said there are 3 men floating in a boat and they have 4 cigarettes, but they don't have any matches. How would they be able to smoke? Well, you throw one cigarette overboard, you make the boat a cigarette lighter. Sometimes riddles are very profound. Like, what's greater than God, more evil than the devil? The poor have it, the rich need it, and if you eat it, you'll die. Who said it? Oh, not one of our graduates, though. The answer is nothing. Nothing's greater than God. Nothing's more evil than the devil. The poor have nothing. The rich need nothing. And if you eat nothing, you're going to die. And riddles have been around for years and years, back to biblical times, even ancient Sumeria. They had a riddle that said, there is a house. When you enter it, you're blind, and when you leave, you can see. What is it? School. And I guess that's kind of true. You come to school and you're faced with all kinds of riddles. They are revealed to you. You are able to work through and solve some, but more importantly, you're getting skills that let you face your own riddles as you move forward into life, as you are about to do. And it's really moving through life that is the nature of that opening riddle that I was referencing. It was first spoken, I guess they say, by the Sphinx in ancient Egypt, adopted by the Greeks later on, where the riddle says this: what goes on 4 feet in the morning and 2 in the afternoon and 3 in the evening? And the answer? Man, human beings. When you begin life, you crawl on all fours. You're not there anymore. You're no longer dependent and needing other people to do for you. You're not yet past the prime of life where you're walking with a cane or some other kind of assistance. You're not a 3 yet, but you are a solid 2. Because right now, you are ready to take on life. You're eager, you're excited, you got all the opportunities ahead of you. You've got dreams and goals, and you share these with me when we met one-on-one towards the end of your senior year, expressing to me that some of you wanted to become pastors or pilots, electricians or filmmakers, actors or physical therapists, sports management specialists, psychologists, physical trainers, businessmen, marketing experts, data analysts, hospitality leaders, law enforcement officers, financiers, software engineers, mechanical engineers, computing coders, civil engineers, journalists, clothiers, x-ray technicians, nurses, physician's assistants, EMTs, and some who are undecided. So you're heading off to colleges and universities around the state and around the country. And they're going to give you a great education, I'm convinced of that. They're going to mix in other things. We've talked a lot about the challenges when it comes to your faith, things that you have become confident in that they're going to try to present to you as a riddle. Try not to fall for those dangerous teachings. But they're also going to lay before you something else that's kind of a problem, I think, in our country today, and that's the view of entitlement, that somehow you should just be given things. And that's not the way your parents were raised, nor the way your grandparents were raised. It's kind of a new philosophy. They knew, and I think you do too, that success in life requires hard work. And I've seen that from you as students here. And I'm convinced that you'll go forward with that same kind of work ethic to see the opportunities, the riddles, if you will, that need to be solved and to work hard to solve them. Recognizing that you'll have successes and you'll probably have some failures along the way, but that's just part of life. But all the while taking your Savior by your side, that's the thing you take from your years at ALA. And realize the value that you had. Here's what the Apostle Paul said: I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. So yeah, facing riddles in life, that's a certainty. Working hard to solve them, recognizing failures and successes will come along the way, but all the while keeping your Savior at your side, reviewing the value of the moment. You don't realize until it actually becomes a memory, and that's what ALA is for you today. And so it's kind of an exciting day for you, I'm going to guess. It's kind of a sad day for me and for the faculty, maybe for your parents, to see you cross this line. But you are the class of 2019. And you can be proud of what you've left. You've made a big impact on our school. Your attitudes, your contributions in many different areas, your spirit, your ethics, we've appreciated all of that. And so as you go forward, take Christ with you And we know that ultimately you'll solve all the riddles that may face you. I now invite the first row to stand and come forward to receive your diplomas. Matthew James Bernthal. Congratulations. Matthew Theodore Bojanic. Congratulations. Jake Riley Borneman. Congratulations, Jake. Haley Nicole Sureski. Congratulations. Just a moment. Haley is wearing a medallion right now that indicates that she is a co-valedictorian of the class of 2019. Nolan Eric Sureski. Congratulations. Dylan Carey Cook. Congratulations, Nolan. Peyton Dago Descini. Cameron Jeffrey Ebel. Congratulations, Cam. Brandon Matthew Garcia. Congratulations, Brandon. Thomas Elvin Green. Lawrence James Harris. Congratulations, Lawrence. Jameson Levi Hine. Congratulations. I now invite the second row to stand, come forward to receive your diplomas. Sydney Ruth Indahl. Aiden Llewellyn John. Congratulations. Sorry about that. Right. I just want you to know I practiced that middle name all night long and still didn't get that right. Luke Jonathan Kicker. Zachary Patrick Lothian. Congratulations, Zach. Mia Linda Marquez. Congratulations, Mia.
Thank you.
Andrew Brett Martin. is, and it's true. Benjamin David Meyer. Congratulations, Ben. Samuel Douglas Meyer. Congratulations, Sam. Matthew Spencer Mullins. Congratulations, Matthew. Shelby Nicole Neighbor. Congratulations, Shelby. Angel Ray Ortega. Congratulations, Angel. Jordan Alicia Patterson. Congratulations, Jordan. And now I invite the third row to stand and come forward to receive your diplomas. Marcus James Kelly Perez. Congratulations, Marcus. Zachary James Plitzewite. Congratulations, Zach. Thank you. Emma Catherine Rautenberg. Congratulations. And Emma is also wearing a medallion indicating she is a co-valedictorian of the class of 2019. Noah Marie Stotts. Congratulations. And Noah's wearing a medallion indicating she is the salutatorian of the class of 2019. Bamlak Feru Tedla. Congratulations, Bamlak. Samuel Della Torre Urbiata. Congratulations, Sammy. Wang Xiaowen, Samantha Wong. Congratulations, Samantha. Emma Charlene Wendt. Congratulations, Emma. Alexis Hesper Whitesinger. Shi Siwen, Stephen Shi. Congratulations, Stephen. Julie Ann Zembruski. Congratulations, Julie.
still get these chairs, these black chairs, have to go into the music room over there?
Here. These are like empty of chair parts. Are they bringing them from someplace else?
Get on the back, and I get up there, and two hooks. two side by side and then 2D.